Good afternoon or good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for all those who came. We really appreciate you coming out today. And those in cyberspace, I wish that you were here, but you're here with us in spirit. So my name is Dr. Shipp. I work with Dr. Levit. I'm one of his cosmetic fellows. Dr. Levit, unfortunately, got caught in traffic and will be here in a little bit, but I'll take over the first reins moving forward. So we're going to have a discussion about cellulite. So everyone has seen it. Everyone knows what it is, but I'm going to give a little bit more information on how we can treat it and some other ways that we can do to help prevent it from occurring. So here's my slide. We're going to move forward. So cellulite was first described in the earlier 20th century. How are you doing? Cellulite is essentially just an alteration in the topography of the skin. So essentially you get these divots within the skin or these scar-like plaques. And it's because you get an accumulation of fat, and you also get this accumulation of muscles and some different fibers, depending on if you're male or female, that crisscross that can cause this irritation. Now there's been several synonyms for this. If you look at any of the old literature back in the day, you can see some people referring to it as gynoid lipodystrophy, nodular lipodysclerosis, and also this long word, which just means edematous fibrosclerotic paniculitis. Basically, you get edema around the fibrotic tissue of the skin, and it kind of gets scarred down. When you hear me today, I'll just refer to it as cellulite. Now, common locations are on the buttocks. You also can see it on the sides of the legs, primarily in the posterior lateral sides of the legs, and the majority of it is primarily in postpubertal females. Now, even in the earliest time, I told you in the 20th century it was first described, but you can actually see it in the painting. This is back in 1560. As you can see, this little indentation right there. This is in the Loire in Paris, France. And you can see that even back in those days, they were able to detail that cellulite was present upon people. For any of our art lovers, that's just Venus and Cupid. So, is there a difference between cellulite and obesity? That's always a common concern for people. Is fat considered the same as cellulite, or is it the same as obesity? And there is a difference between the two. Fortunately for us, obesity is only the adipocyte layer is hypertrophy, whereas in hyperplasia, and you have some differences with the microcirculation. But clinically, clinically, what I want to say is basically when you look at it clinically from a standpoint, a person who has obesity versus a person who has cellulite, you'll see that they're kind of like these padded orange-like signs and plaques when a person has cellulite, whereas you don't really see that when a person who has just plain obesity. Now here's a distinction to tell you the difference between the two. When I was telling you about healthy fats and so forth, you can see you have connective tissue that are actually just a perfect like linear between these fat lobules. However, when you get to a person who has unhealthy skin and who has cellulite, you'll see these kind of pulling or retracting down, whereas right here they're not retracting down and causing you to have this like point right here, these anchoring points. And then you get some changing in some of the blood vessels as a report of that, result of that. You see this fascia that's right deep here. This actually thins out. So you get a hypertrophy of these fat cells. You get this sclerotic pulling of this connective tissue, these anchoring points, and then you get this thinning of this fascia layer when you compare it to the healthy versus unhealthy. So as you know the pathology, we can actually attack those different areas and we can make them better. So what can we do? Here's an MRI imaging showing the difference between men and women. On the left here, you'll see a person who has healthy skin, and on the right, you'll see a person who has cellulite. Now, as you can see here, these fibers here are actually at a perpendicular angle, and over here they're more towards a side view. If you can look right here, you can see that these cellulite pictures are actually at a weird angle. It's almost like a crisscross X type pattern, and that's how you can differentiate it between a male and a female. Whereas males, you see this perpendicular, and women, you have this crisscross X pattern. And so we can actually attack those areas by different modules of way we can treat. Now, there are some hormones that we know are involved in causing people to have a higher risk of developing cellulite. We know about estrogen, we know about thyroid hormones and catecholamines. Now, depending on which form you're going in, as far as like the epinephrine and the catecholamines would determine what type you have. But for simplistic reasons, we say that estrogen is a major cause, as well as thyroid hormones, and then prolactin, which actually increases water retention and causes the fatty tissue to get larger. There are a ton more fatty tissues and ton more different hormones that can affect this, but we'll focus on those right there. So the estrogen, catecholamines, thyroid, and prolactin. Now, how does this affect? So when we have estrogen, it actually turns on a signal in the body, and it's as simplistic as I can get. So it turns on a signal in the body, causes those fat cells to get larger. Those fat cells get larger, which actually stimulates more fat cells to be developed. Another thing, we have these fibroblasts that actually increase, and then you get this GAG, which is a formation in the lower portion of the skin, and that actually gets larger. And I showed you on that slide how that septate was kind of getting thinner on there. So those GAGs actually play a path in that, and it causes this sclerosis of the skin. The last thing is the circulation. Because you have more damage to the tissue, those blood vessels are a little bit more open, so you have small holes. So the permeability in there, you can actually slide through. And that's when you have this damage in the vasodilation, and you can have some of that discoloration on the skin. So that's how estrogen really affects it. So if we can monitor and we can control some of the estrogen effects, it can make cellulite less apparent. Now, we have different ways that we grade cellulite. It's basically a 1 through 4, depending on which staging category that you use. So 1, a person is basically asymptomatic. 2 is after a person sits down or compression, you get the little divots in the skin. 3 is when, regardless of what they're doing, you're going to have some indentation or some little dents in the skin. And then 4, it's to the next extreme. It's a step better than 3, and it just gets worse. So I'm going to show you some photos of some different stages. So on the left here, this is at rest, and this is when a person contracts. And so that's what in the stages you see. This is stage 2. And this is stage 3. The person is actually relaxing, and the person, after they compress or they contract their muscles. And you can see a little bit more indentation right here in that posterior lateral portion, which is what I told you are some common locations for it. And here is 4. The person is relaxed from at rest on the left, and right here is when they're actually contracting. So regardless, they still have these indentations noted in those spots. So that's a grade 4. Now, treatment options. If you look on any module, if you look at any of some of the websites, you probably see tons of them. There's topicals that we try. There's injections with different products that you can try, specifically fillers. There's radio frequency devices that we have tried as well. And some of these kind of play a part in what we do here at our practice. We have lasers, we have the Z-Wave, and basically the Z-Wave, you basically are causing radio frequencies to hit those areas, and it helps to contract and tighten things up. And then we have injections and subcision. So we have a movie here that I was trying to show. It's not showing, but essentially what we did is we compared a person who had laser, and then we compared it to a person to another side where we just did fillers on it. What we found is when we do the laser combined with the fillers, as well as something that's called venous freeze, which helps to tighten the skin, the person had a really great response. So essentially in the cellulite component, 3 treatment modules are better than 1, because you get better attack of all 3 of those portions that I told you. The hypertrophy of those fat cells, the thickening of that sclerotic skin, and then also those blood vessels. So we're attacking all 3 when we're doing it that way. These are some of the photos. You may see some of these kind of bruising. This is actually a few days after the procedure. You will have some bruising, but that all resolves, and then a person goes back to that stage 0. The before pictures show that a person had on this left side, which is untreated, she had indentations, what we classify as basically a class 2. And then when we were done with the procedure, she did really well. So here's the movie. Would that pop up? Yes. Okay. Here's a movie that we did. So this is a treatment side right here, and it's a non-treatment side. You can see here, and they took some of the fat and we stored that, and we can use that for later uses. So you can see how improvement that was. Just these indentations here, this smooths out, and we really had a great response with this. This person came back 2 years later and still had a great response. So this is not just a once. Luckily for this person, she was a one-time and she was done, but sometimes it may take further treatment. So do we have any questions?
Excuse me. Yes. Of those options that you quoted, mm-hmm. what's the most long-lasting? Which one has most long-lasting impact?
Combination. So not just doing one therapy, just basically combining them. So when you do lasers, when you're doing venous freeze with them, sometimes when we do liposuction, all three of those things can help. Now, when I say that, what's the point? People wonder, why would you do liposuction if you're trying to remove that? When you're trying to actually bring out those dents, the liposuction is where we can make the dents within the skin, when I remove those kind of sclerotic plaques that are kind of pulling down, and then we can actually fill them. So it's almost like a subcision technique. So when you have something that's pulling, we actually stop the pulling and we fill it up so it makes it normalized.
And which procedure is the least painful?
Yeah, so least painful is something that's not gonna go deep. So we can use venous freeze that can help, but I would tell you those aren't the most successful when you're dealing with it. And it all depends on what stage you're at. If you're stage one, we may use topicals. If you're stage two, we may have to do injections. If you're stage three, then that's when you can do combined therapies as well. There's some literature that say people using caffeine, which constricts vessels and things like that, have been shown to help. But in my experience, I haven't seen much improvement with those things.
A painful procedure, pretty.
So each person, I would tell you, pain is subjective.
Yeah, pain is subjective.
But the people that we've done it, they have really great responses, and the pain was definitely tolerable.
Mm-hmm. Is it compared to laser treatment?
Tell me again, I'm sorry.
Compared to laser treatment, is it more painful?
So with the laser treatment, depending on the depth that you have to go,
I went through chin hair with the laser.
So that's the laser hair removal. We generally numb before we do the laser, so you shouldn't experience that significant amount of pain. But I would tell you, I'm an honest person, some people have a little bit more pain than others.
Yeah,
of course. So how severe cellulite is. Thank you so much for those who came, and thank you for those who are watching in cyberspace. If you have any questions, don't hesitate to send us an email or give us a call at our office. Thank you so much.